Hello everybody, welcome to Word Shard.
So today we are going to start with the poem After Blenheim, which is written by Robert Southey. This poem is for the ICSE students who are in class 9 and class 10. This is there in their syllabus and it is a very beautiful poem, and you get to know and learn a lot of things from the poem. So even if you are here and you are not an ICSE student and you are not in class 9 or class 10, in whichever class you are, if you are in class 11s and 12s, if you are in college, if you are here, listen to the thing. You will be learning a lot of idea about what the society is and in which way you need to behave in a society, what you should like and what you shouldn't like, because here is an anti-war poem for you all. Let's see. The poem is set at the site of the Battle of Blenheim. So Blenheim is a place, okay, and at that site there was a battle which took place in which year? In the year 1704. Blenheim is the English name for the German village where, which place is this? Blenheim is in Germany and it is known as Blenheim over there, okay. The place in German is known as, is called Blenheim. It is situated in the left bank of the Danube River at Bavaria in southern Germany. This is just an information about where this place is located. Okay. Next. The grandson of King Louis XIV of France came to the throne. Now this is what, this is an additional information. Why I have given it here? Because see, this talks about, the whole poem is about a war. This is a true incident which happened in 1704. So if you get an idea about where this war was held and who were the, obviously when there is a war, there are two sides to it. When there is a battle, there must be two sides. When you play a game of chess or when there is a war between two people, there are two sides to it. That is why we will first know about the two sides, who were fighting the war. Okay, then we will come into the poem. The poem is very easy. Just first be, try and understand what, where this war was held, how is this war a negative impact on the society, who were the people who fought the war, who were the, which were the places that were involved in the war. Okay, so let's see, what was the case? The case is King Louis XIV of France, okay, his grandson, what was his name? His name was Philip V. So he came to the throne. Now what happened? This did not satisfy Austria and the other European countries. They were not satisfied with this decision. Which decision? That Philip V would be the king. Okay, they were not happy with it and they felt that it was unfair. So what is happening over here? King Louis XIV of France made his grandson Philip V the next king. Now what happens is, Austria and the other European countries found this was not right. This was unfair. Okay. And that is why war broke out. They thought that it was unfair that Philip V was in the throne and therefore the war broke out. Now we will see this, see why I have used red color over here. You will see a map, okay? When you see the map, you will see places written in red and places written in blue. So those places which are written in red as well as blue are the places which fought the battle. See, England, Netherlands, Austria, Prussia versus Bavaria, Cologne, France and Savoy. Here you will see the people of Eugene, okay? Here you see the people of Marlborough, and these two were the main, you know, the generals in the war who fought together against whom? Against Bavaria, Cologne, France. Now, why I have written the word Savoy? Savoy's general was Prince Eugene, okay? He was the main over there. So, Prince Eugene was from Savoy, which is a part of Germany, but he later changed his side and became a part of England, Netherlands, Austria, Prussia. So, he just changed sides and he became a part of the other side. He was against Bavaria, against France. Okay. Now, what happens during this war, you see this is the place, Blenheim. I already told you that Blenheim is what we call the place, but in Germany the same place is known as Blenheim. So this is the place, and where is this place? This place is beside the Danube River, Okay, this is the river, and just beside this we have our this Blenheim or Blindheim, whatever name you want to call it. Now the war was fought in this place. Okay, there was a lot of havoc caused. People were dead, there were soldiers fighting, okay, in the field of Blenheim. Now this part is clear. This is the background. Okay, this is a place, the Blindheim or Blenheim, whatever name you want to call it. This is the place where the battle was fought in 1704, okay, between these two places. Why? Because Austria and the other English countries were not satisfied as Philip V was made the king. So the battle was fought. Now see what were the effects of war. Okay, let's start with the poem. It was a summer evening. It is a very easy poem. See, it was a summer evening. It was summer and it was an evening time. Old Caspar, this is an old man, okay, the grandfather in this family, work was done. So his work was complete. The grandfather's work was done. Why? Because it is evening. So all his farming and everything was complete by then. And he before his cottage door was sitting in the sun. So it was evening, slowly the sun was setting. So he was sitting by the side of his cottage door, and by him sported, by him means just beside him, sported, that means played, on the green, that means on the green field, just before, just in front of him there was the green lawn. So over there the little child was playing, the little grandchild. The grandchild of whom? The grandchild of old Caspar. Caspar is the grandfather and his grandchild's name is Wilhelmine. Okay, so this girl, little baby, was sitting in front of him and was playing in the green field, okay, in front of him. Now suddenly what happens? So what does the first stanza tell you? That it is a very cozy environment. A grandfather is sitting with his granddaughter, and that little child is playing in front of him. Everything is so happy around him, isn't it? Wilhelmine has a brother. His name is Peterkin. He was rolling something large and round. Okay, that brother of Wilhelmine was rolling a large, you know, circular something, which he beside the rivulet. What is rivulet? Rivulet means a small stream. The meanings are given in green color, just beside the difficult words. You can write them down in your books if you want with a pencil. Which he beside the rivulet in playing there had found. So while he was playing, this boy Peter King, he was playing in the field. Okay, and while he was playing there, he has found a huge circular thing in that ground. He came to ask. Now why has he come to this place? Why has he come to old Caspar, to his grandfather? He came to ask what he had found that was so large and smooth and round. So he has got a circular thing which was very large, smooth and exactly round in shape. So he comes back to old Caspar. Why? To ask him what it is. Okay. Now old Caspar took it from the boy. Now old Caspar takes the circular thing from the boy, who stood expectant by. Who stood expectant by means the boy was waiting over there. Why was he waiting? He has come here to know an answer. Okay, he has come to his grandfather to know an answer that what is this round thing that he has found in the field, and he was expecting an answer. And then the old man shook his head and with a natural sigh, you know, deep breath. It is, T-I-S means it is some poor fellow's skull, he said. Just imagine, this round thing is nothing other than a skull. Why did Peter King could not identify the thing that it is a skull? Because, you know, it was buried underneath the soil. So all around the skull there is mud. So he cannot see the skull. Okay. So he sees just a round, you know, mud and everything, a combined thing. He sees it. Now that was actually the skull. Who identifies this? The grandfather identifies this. Who fell in the great victory? Whose skull is this? This is the soldier's skull who died during the victory. Which victory is he talking about? The battle where English defeated the French. Now you can understand why I told all that thing before starting the chapter, before starting the poem. Because it is everything that we learn from the poem is about that war that was fought in 1704. There were huge number of soldiers fighting the battle. Now, people from this side as well as soldiers from that side were dead. Now, when they died in the battlefield, the bodies were not cremated properly. They were not, you know, buried properly. So, they were just lying underneath the soil, okay, very close to the surface of the soil. And whenever the land was dug, it was a farming land. So, whenever the land was dug up or tilled, okay, you know, tilling is required. So, you can sow the seeds in the field so that you can grow crops. So, whenever it was done, all these pieces of, you know, the skeleton, various parts of the body was found from underneath the soil. Just imagine the situation. Now, I find them in the garden. For who is this I? This I is old Casper. Casper says that I always find them in the garden. That means whenever I go to the field for tilling, this is what is this happening? This is the plowshare which you use to cultivate the land, which is used to till the land, so that after this is done, after you have used the, you know, the plowshare to plow the field, that it is a kind of elongated blade which you use to plow the field, and when you have done it, then you sow the seeds in it so that the soil is aerated, okay, and then you can grow good crops from there. So when he used to do this in the garden, he used to find these body parts, the skeleton, in many places, for there's many hereabouts. So he goes on finding all these things in all his field, because just beneath the soil, the skeleton, the parts of the body, maybe the skull or the bones, the various parts of the body, bones are from various parts, all these were found. Okay. And often when I go to plow, the plowshare turns them out. As I have already told you, when he goes to plow the field like this, what happens? You move the soil, isn't it? The soil on the surface, you move it, and just below it, the skeletons are there. So it comes out. And I often find the body parts, the skeleton of the soldiers. Of which soldiers? The soldiers who fought the war in this field. Understood? For many thousand men, said he. So just imagine, so many people were killed in that war. Thousands of men were slain. Slain means they were killed in that great victory. It was a great victory. See, repeatedly the old man is saying that it is a great victory. But do you identify that so much inhumanity was there? So many people were killed, so much bloodshed was done then, and so many soldiers have to give away their lives. Then how can you call it a great victory when so many people were dead and people killed other men? Humanity was lost. Okay. No humanity was shown to the other people. So how can something good happen in such a situation? Now tell us what it was all about, young Peterkin, he cries. So young Peterkin, he asks, what was it all about? What was the war for? Why was the war fought? And why were so many people killed? He said, not thousand men, so many people were killed. Now what was the case, please tell me. And little Wilhelmine looks up with wonder waiting eyes. Now you already know what is this. This is alliteration, WWW, wonder waiting eyes. So now the little girl is also waiting for an answer. That grandfather, you are telling that so many people were killed. And then again you are saying it is a great victory. This is very strange. How can it be? How can you call it great when so many people were dead? Now tell us all about the war and what they fought each other for. So you please tell me, why was the battle fought? Why were they fighting with one against one another? What was the problem? Okay. It was the English, Casper cried, who put the French to rout. So rout means they were defeated. Okay, the English people defeated whom? The French. Okay, so the French people were defeated and they were destroyed. By whom? By the English people. But what they fought each other for, I could not well make out. So this part is important. Why is this part important? See, the grandfather does not even know why the battle was fought, why so many people had to die, why they had to burn the houses, kill the people. Okay, they had no idea, that grandfather had no idea of all this. But he just knew that it was a famous victory. See, it is repeated to highlight the ignorance of these people who are taught that yes, they had to fight the battle, they had to win the war, but then there are people who should give their lives for, they should sacrifice the lives, and they had to die. That is why these people died. But the grandfather doesn't even know the cause for their death. Why did they suddenly die? Why were they fighting the battle? Why was there so much bloodshed? Okay. So my father lived at Blenheim then. So his father, that is old Caspar's father, that means great grandfather, these little children's great grandfather used to live at Blenheim then. Yon means beyond the little stream hard by. There is a small stream, a small river. Just beyond that, his father used to live. Whose father? Caspar's father used to live there. Now what happened? Then the war was being fought. And what happened during the war? They burned his dwelling. That means the house of Caspar's father was burnt. During war, these things happen. They burn your houses, they kill your cattle, they ruin your libraries, they destroy your people, they kill mothers, children and everybody, whoever they find. Okay, they steal, rob, and these things happen. So they burnt his dwelling, that means his house was burnt to the ground. He was forced to fly. He had to run away. Obviously, when your house is burnt, you will have to run away. Otherwise, you will also die with the house. So with his wife and child, he fled. That means with Caspar, with his mother, his father had to run away from the place. Why? Because of this battle. Nor had he where to rest his head. That means this old Caspar's father did not have any place to live, because every place was, you know, there was so much struggle, there was so much trouble going on everywhere. Everybody was tensed and people's houses were burnt, they were killed alive, they were burnt alive. So he had no place to take rest. With fire and sword, the country round was wasted far and wide. So he knows that so much harm was done, so many people were killed, houses were burnt, just like this you see in the picture. Okay, so much destruction was done, but he still thinks that the battle was obvious, it was necessary, they had to fight the battle, they had to sacrifice their lives. And many a childing mother means the pregnant women who all died in that war, pregnant women, newborn baby, just imagine. These, why are these things being highlighted? These things are highlighted because a childing mother, a newborn baby, do you think they have done any crime that they should lose their lives in such a way? They should be burnt, they should be killed, their houses should be burnt, okay? Their dwelling should be taken away from them? No, they haven't done any harm to anybody. Yet they have to be sacrificed, just like you have read in The Old Man at the Bridge. You see that old man, he is as innocent as the goats, as the animals which he had. But still he had to die over there just like his goats. He had to sacrifice himself because a war was being fought. So you understand that during war, so many innocent lives are taken away. Why do we need to kill another human being without any proper purpose? And we should question that why should we fight the battle? For what cause? Why should there be so much bloodshed, isn't it? And the old man, that is the grandfather, has seen his own father, mother and everybody running away from the houses, their houses being burned. Still, he is so ignorant about the cause of the war, that why the battle was fought, why they were killed, why they had to run away. He does not know anything. He just knows, he is just taught that the victory was necessary, the war was necessary, they had to fight, and therefore people had to be sacrificed during the war. Now, but things like that, you know, must be at every famous victory. So he is also taught this part. Let's see, victory, you have to win the war. That war is necessary, and because it is a famous victory, because you have to fight the battle, people will die, people's lives would be sacrificed. Even when these lives are innocent, they have to be sacrificed. Now this is taught to the old man. He never questions again. They say it was a shocking sight. So the old man knows that it was a shocking sight. It was a terrible sight. How would you feel when you see people's houses being burnt, your friend's house being burnt, your friend being killed? How would you like? You'll not like it at all. So it was a shocking sight. After the field was won, that means when the battle was won, everywhere was devastated. It was destroyed, people killed, okay, bloodshed, so much bloodshed, people crying, babies crying, mothers killed, and houses burnt down. So that was the scene. For many thousand bodies here lay rotting in the sun. If you are told that identify the poem as an anti-war poem, you can write these lines. You have to say that all the gruesome, you know, the extreme, the ugly scenes of war is highlighted in the poem. It is shown that when there is a war, innocent lives are taken. Okay, little babies die, childing mothers die, who are innocent, their houses are burnt. Okay, poor people's houses are taken away, bodies, so many soldiers from both the sides have to give away their lives. There is no honor given to these people who have fought the battles, isn't it? Their bodies are still in the battlefield, their dead bodies, and now they are rotting in the sun. There is nobody over there to take care of their bodies, to give them proper honor. Okay, but things like that, you know, must be after a famous victory. He's also taught that although it is a shocking sight, although when you see the battlefield, you are disgusted. Are you liking the scene? No, we do not like the scene. Even then, the old man speaks the same thing again and again, that those things must happen in a famous victory. When there is a famous victory, this kind of devastation, this kind of destruction must take place. That is obvious, that is necessary. So he has somehow accepted this gruesome sight. Okay, this ugly, horrible sight, he has accepted it. Now, great praise the Duke of Marlborough. Who is this Marlborough? English general, commander of British forces, one, and our good Prince Eugene. So I've already told you about Prince Eugene. Prince Eugene was the Savoy general. Okay, Savoy was previously supporting the Savoy were not supporting the English people at first. English and Austrian people, they were not supporting them. But later, they joined hands with the English people, the Austrian people. Okay, so they changed sides. Okay, so we will see the map again so that we can understand this. See, this is Eugene's party, Eugene's people, and this is Marlborough's people. Okay, so both of them joined hands to win over the French people, and they finally won the war. Where did they win the war? They won the war at Blenheim, which is this place just beside the river. Okay, and in this war, so we can understand that Savoy finally changed his side and joined hands with whom? With England, Netherlands, Austria, Prussia, with them. They joined hands, and obviously you can understand that their power was less now. It was less at that time, and then they had to lose the battle, and therefore England with Austria, Prussia, Savoy, Netherlands, they finally won the war. Okay, and so this Marlborough and Eugene, you can understand, they were supporting the England-Austrian team. Okay, why? It was a very wicked thing. Now Wilhelmine, who is a very small girl, who is innocent, and who thinks that when you kill people, when there is hatred, when you fight with other people, when you kill other people, okay, all these things are bad. That little girl is innocent, and you know, little children often asks question. Why? They ask question because they want an answer. They want a logical answer. Now, can you give a logical answer why the battle was fought? Only because one party was not satisfied with their king. They had to fight a battle when there were so many innocent people dying in that war. Okay. To serve their own purpose, they made the soldiers fight the battles, they burned houses down, they killed mothers, they killed children, so much devastation. So war cannot be good in any way. We need to peacefully sort out things. War cannot help us. Okay. So that little child realized this easily. She understood that this is a wicked thing. Obviously, this kind of killing is obviously a wicked thing. Name, my little girl. What do you mean by name? Name means no. Quoth he. Quoth means he said. It was a famous victory. No, girl, you have to understand. Now, the old man was taught that you have to accept that war is good. Now, he is teaching the little girl that, see, you have to accept that war was necessary, and the war was fought, and innocent lives had to be taken away. That is necessary. He teaches the little girl. And everybody praised the Duke who this great fight did win. So, he says, let's see, everybody praised the Duke of Marlborough because for him, the war was won. But what good came of it at last? Quoth little Peterkin. So Peterkin now asks another question. What good? Now, if you kill so many people, do you remember King Ashoka? King Ashoka was fighting a war with Kalinga. Okay. And there were so many people, lakhs of people who were dead and captivated that when he, after the war, when he sees the battlefield, he was shocked. He took to Buddhism. Why? Because he felt that so many killings and ultimately what did I get? I did not win anything. I lost everything. I have lost my humanity. When I cause so much bloodshed, when I kill so many people, then I did not win anything. I lost everything. I lost my humanity. So this little child Peterkin asks that what good came of it at last? You cannot be satisfied when you have killed so many people. Why, that I cannot tell, said he. But it was a famous victory. So you know this victory was famous. I don't know what happened after that or why was it fought or what purpose was served by the war. I don't know all that. But I know it was a famous victory. So you can understand that this part, it was a famous victory, was taught to him like a parrot. You teach a parrot to speak some words, no, without understanding. It was also taught to him by politicians that see, war is necessary, innocent people must die. It is a sacrifice for the country's sake, and that is why they had to give away their lives. And the old man has accepted it. But the children cannot accept. You know, children are inquisitive, they ask questions. They want a logical answer. Now, important notes that you require to learn from this place, this poem, and you may write it down in your copy so that it will help you out during the exam. You will be given questions mainly from the anti-war theme. This is a very important question from this poem. Anti-war. Throughout the poem, you see the gruesome examples which is caused during war. Okay. The bodies rotting under the sun, mothers killed, children killed. So war represents the worst state of human behavior. When you lose humanity, are you even a human being? Question yourself. The skull Peterkin finds, as well as those that Caspar regularly unearths while plowing his fields, are examples of the horrors of war. So you can identify certain lines which are examples of these horrors of war. What are those? Mothers killed, children killed, then the skull is found, no honor is given to these soldiers, they are not cremated properly, their body parts come out in the sun. Just imagine, so gruesome it is. And the great victory, are we human beings? We think that we are superior creatures, we think that we are better than all other animals. But in this place, do you find yourself to be superior when you see so many people dying and you are responsible for their death? You don't feel that you are a human being. You are just like other animals who kill each other, who fight with one another. You don't have that humanity that human beings must have. Next. Now, why are Wilhelmine and Peterkin important here? Because children are curious by nature. They question, they ask for logical answers, as I told you. They question the cause. So Peterkin and his sister could very well feel that war is gruesome. When skulls are dug out, so many people dead, mothers, children killed, how can it be a great victory? There is bloodshed, hatred, death. So when there is bloodshed, hatred, death, then how can a war be a great victory? Who questions this? The children question this. Why? Because children are curious. They want logical answers. They want to know why. Why? And what caused the people were dead? What caused was the war fought? So that is important. That is why children are important. So if the question comes, what purpose the children serve over here, you have to write, children are curious, and through these two children, we see that we tend to question the reason for the war or the cause for the war. Okay. Now this part you can quote, why it was a very wicked thing, said little Wilhelmine. So through the little girl, we tend to question the reason for the war. But old Caspar and many grown-up men unquestionably accepts the loss of innocent lives as a price of the glorious victory in the war. Caspar's carelessness and ignorance, this is important, is somewhat like the modern politicians who dismiss the deaths of innocent people in war by referring to them as collateral damage. Collateral damage means they have accepted this fact. The politicians teach other people, teach the common people this thing, that see, this is a war, this has to be fought, and then people has to die, they will die, innocent lives will be taken away, and they accept both the things. They accept war, they accept the sacrifice of the common people. Okay, next we will move on to the figures of speech. Figures of speech is the last topic that we will do from here. It is important, as you know, in all the poems we are solving the figures of speech, we are dealing with the figures of speech, so that if questions come, it becomes easier for you to answer. See, the first one, what is refrain? Refrain, you have already heard of this word. It is a phrase or a group of words repeated a number of times in the poem. Why? To highlight certain themes. Maybe over here, what is the theme? The theme is the irony, the anti-war idea. See, repeatedly the old man says, great victory, famous victory. What is this? This is irony. That ultimately that old man has not realized that these innocent lives are just sacrificed for somebody else's cause. For some politicians fighting a war, you give away your innocent life. What for? You never question. So this is ironical. Okay. Emphasizes the ignorance of common man. This is important. He highlights that common man fail to question the reason that why you will do it, why you will not do it. And because you do not question, because common man never question, they follows whatever is told to them. Therefore, there is so much havoc, destruction caused. Okay. Next, alliteration. What is alliteration? You know, repetition of consonant sounds. In this, there are many examples of alliteration in the poem. Saudi's poem helps to promote rhythm. The rhythm is promoted. The rhythm is highlighted in the poem by use of alliteration. See examples. Let us see the last one. I've already told you while I was teaching. With wonder waiting eyes. See W, W, W. So wonder waiting eyes. Okay. This one is an example of alliteration. Next, we'll move to the last part, the irony. What is an irony? Irony over here is in this fact that at one side, old Casper says that it was a shocking sight. His own father had to lose his house and had to run away from his house. Their house was burnt. Okay. At one side, he knows all these things. He already knows that it was such a gruesome sight. It was a horrific sight. So many thousands of people were killed and it was bad. And on the other side, he just turns a blind eye to that thing, to that destruction and death and destruction, and he goes on repeating it like a parrot that it was a famous victory, it was a great victory, just to look away from the horrors of war and to speak whatever is taught to him. Okay, so the poem reflects on the horrors of war, like burned houses, civilian casualties. What are the civilian casualties? The pregnant women dying, the newborn babies dying, the rotting corpses under the sun. It is ironical that Casper still glorifies war at the cost of such destruction of life and property. When he sees so much destruction, when he has himself seen all those killings, death, fire everywhere, even then how can he say that war is good? Because he is taught like a parrot. Even his own family had been devastated. His gruesome descriptions and his casual behavior with the killings create an irony. This is the irony that even when he has seen so much death and destruction, he fails to question it. That why should we kill other people? We are human beings. The other person is also a human being. Why should we kill him? So he fails to question that. And he goes on repeating great victory because he is taught to believe in that by the high-backed politicians. Famous victory, as this is all he has revised about war, turning a blind eye to the deaths. He turns a blind eye to all the deaths, to the killings, and he goes on believing what he is taught. Last, it is ironical that the masses are lured. Lured means they are tempted. Masses means huge number of the common people mainly. They are tempted by the leaders into believing the importance of victory in war. They are made to believe that war is necessary, war must be fought, it is for a greater cause, rather than its purpose or benefits for the common man. So the common man is not told why the war is fought. They are just told that, see, war is necessary, they have to be fought, okay, and innocent lives have to be given for that, they have to be sacrificed, okay. The irony expresses to the readers the pointlessness of war. When being a human being, you have to kill another human being, there can be nothing that can justify this, isn't it? In no way it can be justified. Killings can never be good. Hatred, murder, this can never be good. So he ultimately talks about what is the main theme of the poem. It is pointlessness of war, the futility of war, the anti-war theme is highlighted in the poem. This is quite similar to the story Old Man at the Bridge. So you can relate the two and write any answer that will be that any question that comes from this part. So I think I have made the poem clear. If you have any problems regarding the poem, you can obviously ask me in the comment section. And I hope you have liked it. If you have liked it, please comment, subscribe and share it with your friends so that they can benefit from it. Thank you. Bye-bye.